It's from Matthew 27, verses 50 to 53, and I'll read the question first, and then I'll tell you the question first, and then I'll read the verses, but I would like to know what happened to the people who rose from the grave. And when you read 27 verses 50, I'll do 51. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earthquake and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised, and coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. And my question is, what happened to these people that, you know, that rose up? Did they live on? Did they then have to die again?
Wonderful question. I'll give the short and then I'll give the long. Actually, there were multiple questions in here. Probably many people don't even notice what Catherine brought up. There were five mighty miracles from Calvary. If you remember, the Lord reached up and put out the sun, and there was the earthquake, all the veil split and all that. This one is fascinating. And it says, when the earthquake, the graves were, well, Catherine was reading it, and you all should turn there, because I think that is one of the more fascinating passages. The veil of the temple, verse 51, is torn in two from top to bottom. The earthquake, the rocks were split. So we're talking about a massive earthquake here. And I'll just give a little aside. I was on one of the journeys to Israel. We actually got to walk through the excavations under the Temple Mount. You know, there's the Temple Mount, there's the Wailing Wall, then there's a tunnel that goes, it's called the Rabbinic Tunnel, it goes underneath the city and the Temple Mount. And it's an amazing archaeological excavation. But we went through it with one of the excavators. Our guide knew him and said, let him take you through. And so our group was going, and as we were walking along, the first thing he did is he said, I'd like to show you something. He said, do you remember how Jerusalem was destroyed in AD 70? I said, yeah, I've read about it. He said, it was a conflagration. It was a huge fire. And I said, yeah. He says, stick your hand between those two rocks. Well, here we are underground in the dark, and there's two boulders. And he said, stick your hand in there. I thought, you know, okay. And so I stuck my hand in there. When I pulled my hand out, it was like going into a wood stove. The black soot, my hand was absolutely blackened from the soot of the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. So this guy was, I mean, he knew his stuff, and he took us all around. He took us into the part of Jerusalem that Nehemiah rebuilt. Now, a lot of people don't realize that everything that says in the Bible happened, and it talks about how Nehemiah in 52 days rebuilt the walls of Jerusalem and all the gates he put up and everything. Well, that was incorporated in every extension of Jerusalem, and they all knew what parts Nehemiah built and what parts, you know, were from Solomon's time and David's time and later from Herod's time, etc. Inside the Herodian construction, he had built all around the chambers that Nehemiah built. And one of the chambers Nehemiah had built in his wall building had a massive, maybe 4 foot wide ashlar, you know, a large stone that was 10 or 12 feet long, and it was the top of a doorway. So there was a giant block of stone and another giant block of stone, and then this massive stone column over the top. Now, this is underground, 70 feet underground, and all the successive layers of archaeological excavations were above it. And here we are underground, and he took his flashlight, and remember, it was a Jewish excavator and a Jewish guide, and he had his torch in his hand. He was shining along, and he says, and look at this. He said, you know what? He said, there was some type of an earthquake that struck Jerusalem. He said that we don't really have a historic record of, he says, because look at that, and that 12 foot wide by 4 foot, you know, 12 foot long, 4 foot wide, had the nicest crack right through it. And he said, there was a massive earthquake that shook this Temple Mount area. Now, I was standing there, and look back at verse 1 or 51. It says, and the earth quaked and the rocks were split. And I could see our Jewish guide going, oh, man, he's going to start preaching here. And I had the group gather around. They said, did you know? And I had them all open to this passage because we know that there was a massive quake that was surrounding the crucifixion of Christ. And the Lord describes it as having that it was the earth quaked and rocks were split open. And we saw one of them. But look what verse 52 says. The graves were open. So Catherine, real quickly, it's very interesting that it doesn't localize this, where this happened. And personally, I think it could have not just been exactly around Jerusalem, but it could have been graves were open all throughout the land of Israel. For this reason, and I'll take you there in the long answer, but I believe these people were raised from the dead by the Lord. They didn't step out, my personal opinion, they didn't step out of the tomb until Christ stepped out of the tomb. But the graves were opened and the people were waiting. They'd already been there a long time, so what's a little bit longer, you know? And they're waiting, and I think in pictures. Can you imagine people, the earth quakes, and they're all going out to check what happened, and they're walking by where great-grandfather, you know, so-and-so was buried, and it's cracked open. They look inside, and they see eyes going, blinking at them. And they go, oh. And 3 days later, grandpa comes out, you know. Look what it says. And it says, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. Notice there's stages here. Christ is on the cross. The graves were popped open by this rock splitting. And then look what it says in verse 53. You thought I was making all this up. Then, coming out of the graves after his resurrection, 3 days later, it really appears that the Lord raised these people to life, and they waited, and they all came out at the same time. And I believe probably they all started walking from wherever they came out of the grave. Can you imagine walking the main road of the patriarchs that goes from Galilee down to Jerusalem, and there's this old guy with a walking stick coming along and walking north from Hebron, and someone says, hey, who are you? And he says, Abraham, formerly of Ur of the Chaldees, an idolater. And he says, and now Abraham just raised from the... I mean, I don't know who all God raised, but I'll tell you in a moment when we do the long one why I think that. Because there are groups in 1 Corinthians 15. It appears that there were multiple resurrections, and the second thing that Catherine talked about is a part of that. The rapture is in there, and then there's the final resurrection. So we'll go through the first part. Yes, I believe they were raised. Clearly they were. The Bible says so. I see evidence in 1 Corinthians 15 which ties with what the scriptures talk about here in the rapture. Did they die again? Well, I will answer that with the concurrence with the rapture and what Jesus did. Lazarus had to die again. So it is anybody that was raised from the dead had to die again, except this group may have been the first fruits, which is mentioned here. So Matthew 27, 50 to 53. So let's all turn there. Matthew 27. 50 to 53, and she said, what happened to the group in the open graves? What happened? And just ask a few questions about that. And basically, she asked if they would die again and what was going on. And so we're going to look at that this evening, but I thought as we look at that, it will be an opportunity for you to think through the implications of the question she asked, because this is a perfect portion of scripture to do this. So I have her question. I brought up that night that she asked it in August. I brought up 1 Corinthians 15. I brought up 1 Thessalonians 4. But basically this, let me stick a sheet in here. So here's the question on Matthew 27. And immediately, two things surface. One is the context, and that is huge. Actually, there are five miracles that take place one after another in that passage. So that's the first thing. The second thing is this topic of the resurrection, the grave, and what happens to bodies, and what happens to people, and then what happens to the saints, and how does this fit with the resurrection, the general resurrection, the saints being raptured out of the world, and all that. And so this is huge, which helps you to think. There's two ways you can think about this, and I've shown you this before. The Bible is like a pyramid of 31,000 plus verses, okay? And Matthew 27, 50 to 53, which is Catherine's question, is that little passage right there. And there are two ways that you can approach it. A textual study, and this is now going into homiletics, how you expound the Word of God. A textual sermon is kind of like the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, only the text, the whole text, but nothing but the text. And you never leave that portion, which is a wonderful way to study. The problem is it misses the iceberg that's underneath it. Now, the other way, and so that's one whole way that people think about the Bible. They think of the text in isolation. They're called textual preachers, and they just go from this word to this word to this word to this word, but they never leave that verse. And I think it's wonderful, but it's kind of like left brain and right brain thinkers. I actually think the opposite way. I think that every verse in the Bible has 31,078 other verses pushing on it. And Matthew 27, 50 to 53, is part of an immense revelation of God, which I call back here. It's a part of the miraculous attestation and confirmation by God of Christ's promised death. Now, that gets us into here, because the gospel, 1 Corinthians 15, you all know this, Paul said this, Christ died for our sins according to Scripture, and that he was buried, and that he rose again according to Scripture. And he prefaced that with, we delivered unto you first of all that which we also received, which is the gospel. So the gospel is all about this topic that Catherine has brought up. Christ's death and the events surrounding it, the five mighty events, and the fact that all of these were engineered by God to teach us something. So let's get there. What are the exact events of Christ's death? Now, I'll just survey these with you. Christ died in Matthew 27. The exact place in which he died was Mount Moriah. And basically, in the Scriptures, Jesus died in the exact place on Golgotha in Moriah as God explained the place to Abraham. In fact, in a few weeks, I was meeting with the pilgrims going to Israel, the 27 that are going to Israel in October, and I didn't have the heart to tell them everything that was on my mind, because I know one place we parked the bus, we actually parked the bus on the ridge that Abraham walked up from Hebron, where he was camping in his tents, and he paused and looked up, and God said, I want you to sacrifice your son that you love up there on that ridge called Moriah. And we stop where Abraham would have stopped the first time you can see Mount Moriah. Golgotha was the exact place that in Genesis, God said, I'm going to send Abraham to offer his beloved son, the first occurrence of the word love in the Bible. The law of first occurrences, something happens the first time a word shows up, like grace, first time is in Genesis 6. Love is right here at this moment. And God is there identifying the place that he is going to have both his tabernacle, his temple, and Christ's crucifixion. Secondly, we have event. Jesus was going to be crucified in a Psalm 22 prophesied crucifixion, which details the crucifixion event itself. And you know all the wonderful parts of Psalm 22. The exact moment God told Moses. So God told Abraham where it was going to be, the crucifixion. God told David how it was going to be. Then God told Moses when it was going to be. Because Jesus was the lamb that was sacrificed for the sin of the world, as John the Baptist put it. Do you remember there used to be, like Cain and Abel brought a lamb for an individual. And that was perpetuated all the way through the tabernacle observances I told you about this morning. Families would bring lamb, put their hand on it, identify with it, and be sacrificed. Then there became the lamb for the nation. That was the national offering once a year when it was reminding them of the Passover, the lambs that were put on the doors of each family. But then there would be the Day of Atonement when one lamb was offered for the sin of the whole nation once a year. And it was kind of like a once a year, you know, saying that we've covered everything for another year. And as we're waiting for the ultimate. So there was an individual lamb, there was a national lamb, then there was the Lamb of God slain for the world. And that's what we find in John 1:29. Behold the Lamb of God, John the Baptist pointed at Christ, who takes away the sin of the world. So Jesus was the individual lamb for each person. He was the national Day of Atonement lamb, but he was promised to be the one that is going to be the lamb for the nation that is offered for on behalf of the whole nation. And it would be at the same time the Passover lamb was being offered. And by the way, Christ was crucified. And then God said, not only was the place and the way and the time, but the confirmation that it was the right one, God accomplished by these mighty miracles that we're going to look at. So think about it as we prepare for communion. The greatest crime that the world has ever witnessed took place on a cross of wood with carpenter's tools. It was on a skull-shaped hill. And by the way, this is, wants me to get my pedometer going here and go back. This is called Skull Hill. And today in Jerusalem, there's a Muslim cemetery on the top of it. Down here is an Arab bus station. And this is an escarpment of basically quarried out stone, and it's weathered. And it was actually a rock quarry, and it extends all the way to the city of Jerusalem, and it was a place that they got building materials to build Jerusalem. And it was in this area, the Damascus Road goes right around, the road to Damascus comes out of Jerusalem, comes right up, and then goes right around that hill. This happens to be right here, 777 meters above sea level. It slopes down to where Al-Aqsa, the Temple Mount, we call it, the Dome of the Rock is. That's about 746 meters. So this is 777, and it goes down about 100 feet to where we find the Temple Mount, and it keeps going down to the City of David and all the way down everything that's in the Bible. But this is the highest point of Moriah. This is actually the place where Abraham brought Isaac, right up here, this Muslim cemetery. And the Araunah's threshing floors where David offered when the death angel was killing 70,000, and then all the way down goes to where Melchizedek was and where Abraham saw him. But on this spot, this skull-shaped hill, outside of Jerusalem nearly 2,000 years ago, mankind murdered their maker. Isn't that interesting? That on a tree that Christ created with carpenter's tools, because he was a carpenter, humans murdered their maker. And on a hill called Calvary, in full view of thousands of witnesses, was the day that the Creator was crucified. And his name was Jesus. He was a peasant carpenter. He carried on an itinerant relief work across all the land of Israel. Thousands, tens of thousands followed, heard, and witnessed the mightiest acts everyone had ever seen or heard of I mean, like we talked about this morning, all those fish multiplying. The people were fed, they were healed, the dead were raised, deaf were made to hear and blind to see, lepers were made new, and demonized were delivered. It's possible that there was not a single person in all of Israel that wasn't touched by one of Christ's miracles. You know, there were clans, they were interrelated, they all knew each other, and he just crisscrossed the land, and between his feeding and healings and all of the mighty miracles, there's probably no one that didn't have a direct tie to a firsthand witness. That's how much he did. And so, God, to attest the final attestation that Jesus was the one, God surrounds it with what the question that Catherine brought up. She brought up one of the five. And so we have to look at the context. When Christ hung on that cross of wood for you and for me, God confirmed who it was dying on that cross by five mighty miracles. Now, this is just the Sunday school. Again, I like taking the Sunday school material pictures. This is not really very accurate. This is Western Europe. That's about an 8x8 beam that's stuck in the ground. These posts, nobody was crucified on those. That's just when Renaissance painters were painting, that's what they painted. Actually, the Romans were utilitarian. I mean, why would Rome waste a 4x4 that they could use in a catapult or something to crucify criminals? And besides that, you would have to dig a hole in the ground and, you know, drop it in and everything that we've all thought about those things. They actually just trimmed up the branches of trees. And I mean, everybody from the ancient time knew that. Why would you carry the center post to the spot when you can just trim a tree and it is immovable and it works? Plus, they always crucified at eye level. They wanted you to be able to look into the eyes. This idea of looking up is, again, very Renaissance, Western Europe, and all that. So, I can show you pictures of those. They still, in fact, the only crucified person we have evidence of, the spike, it's in the Israeli Museum, and I love going to see that. The spike that went through their ankle somehow bent, and so they buried them with the piece of the olive tree, the spike, and their heel. And the archaeologists found a crucified 18-year-old boy. They studied his bones with his ankle bone, Roman spike, and attached, because the point of the spike must have hit a rock or a knot or something, it bent. And there's a big chunk of an olive tree in there. So that's the evidence. But Jesus was the light of the world. So God the Father stops the light of the Son. Isn't that interesting? Look at Matthew 27, verse 45. Now from the sixth hour to the ninth hour, there was darkness over all the land. Why was that? That's the first of the mighty miracles. Because Jesus was the light of the world. So God says, you want to kill the light of the world? I'm going to turn the lights off. Isn't that interesting? Secondly, Jesus was the new and living way to God. So God the Father tore the temple curtain from top to bottom. Thirdly, Jesus was the creator of the universe, so God had the rocks cry out. The rocks rent during that earthquake, and it made this sound of the whole earth just being wrenched. Jesus was the resurrection of life. Now we get to Catherine's question. That's why God touched the graves. Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life, and whoever believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. He also said in John chapter 5, five chapters before 11, I just quoted, he says, marvel not, the hour is coming where everyone in the grave will hear my voice and come forth. And God says, he's the resurrection and life. You want to know who he is? And God cracked open graves all over the country and a multitude of people. That's the context of Jesus. He brought forth from the dead dear saints who had died in faith. God touched the graves to show Jesus was the resurrection of life. And then finally, Jesus was the Lamb of God dying for the sin of the world. So what did Jesus do? As he's laying there suffering, he looks down and God touches the heart of the centurion. And the centurion looked at him and said, that is truly the Son of God. And so that's probably the greatest miracle of all, that
Jesus, the Lamb of God, dying for the sin of the world. So God reached down and touched the heart of this centurion there at the foot of the cross. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to read Matthew 27 and verses 45 to 56. So in honor of Catherine's question and the scripture, let's all stand and you follow along. And I want you to see, now that I've told you the context, look at these five amazing miracles, and then we're going to just zero in on the fourth of the five. Verse 45, now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness over all the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Verse 47, some of those who heard or who stood there, when they heard that, said, this man is calling for Elijah. And immediately, one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with sour wine and put it on a reed and offered it to him to drink. The rest said, let him alone. Let us see if Elijah will come and save him. Verse 50, and Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Now come rapid succession, the next four miracles. Verse 51, then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Number two, and the earth quaked and the rocks were split. Next, in verse 52, and the graves were opened and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming, verse 53, out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Verse 54, so when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that happened, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. And many women who followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him, were there looking from afar, among them whom were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. Wow. Five mighty miracles. Let's bow. Father, I thank you that we can reason together from your word. And I pray that more than curiosity and more than just adding more Bible knowledge, that tonight this study of what you did as you attested to the greatest event, the liberation of the universe from the bondage of sin and the offering of salvation to all who would put their faith and hope and trust in Christ, will truly prepare our hearts for communion. That this might be a celebration of you, O Christ, who became sin for us. Open our hearts, fill us, stir us, renew our passion for you. Make us so aware of how much we've been forgiven that we would love you so much that we would do what we were singing about, love you and serve you and speak of you all of our days. We ask for that now in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Well, you may be seated. As you're seated, let's talk starting in verse 45, because Jesus was the light of the world. So what God did is he stopped the light of the sun. Now, see, these miracles taken in order, it makes so much sense. And it really is amazing to think about. Verse 45, look at it. From the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land till the ninth. So the one thing we know is what this wasn't. This was not an eclipse, okay? Think about what an eclipse is, because in Genesis 1 is God creating the sun. On the fourth day of creation, see, that immediately confronts us. If you go to all the Christian schools that have abdicated the Bible and believe that creation week is age-day theory and it's millions of years, each day is like millions of years, then there is no sunlight on the earth for four of however long those days were, because the sun and stars don't come till the fourth day. Isn't that interesting? It was the fourth day of creation week that the sun was born from the hand of Christ, its creator. The thermonuclear furnace at the core was lit as he flung it off into space to warm and light the planet on which he was going to create man in his own image. Now, remember, the anthropic principles are all present. The 27 or whatever it is degree tilt of the earth, the speed of the rotation, the revolution around the sun, the luminosity of the sun, that it is a yellow star, that we are 93 million miles away. All of those factors are anthropic. In other words, that this planet was created perfectly for human existence. And you there are so many calculations that astrophysicists and geophysicists can do, that everything is finely tuned for human life. And even a slight tilt or a more rapid rotation or a longer revolution or a red star or a blue star would cook and ruin life. But God created that sun to light that place he was going to make man in his own image. And for 12,235 days during Christ's earthly life, the sun had shined down on him, its maker. He came to his own, and his own creation received him. It's just the human creatures did not. All of the universe knew who their creator is. All Jesus had to do is speak, and trees wilted, and storms ceased. I mean, the creation knows its creator. The sun had seen Christ turn water into wine, raise a dead little girl to life, feed thousands on grassy hillsides. But now, after seeing him heal and restore ruined lives, the sun looks down to see humans murdering the Creator. That's an amazing thought for the universe to see. Jesus came to his own creatures, and they mostly rejected him. But God the Father said, "This is my Son. And if you're going to reject him, I'm going to turn out the lights." Jesus had previously said in John 8, verses 12 and 13, Jesus spoke to them again, saying, "I'm the light of the world," John 8, 12. "And if you follow me, you'll never walk in darkness, but have the light of life." And the Pharisees said, "You bear witness of yourself, and your witness is not true. You're not the light of the world." So as Jesus hung on the cross, God switched the light off. He said, "He is. And you just don't know what you just did." But how true it is, the darkness that comes when the light of the world is gone, and how dark it was. By the way, this is what the sun normally looks like. This is a solar eclipse. Solar eclipses do not last 3 hours. Total solar eclipses are a passing thing that they rush to get their cameras ready so they don't miss. This was supernatural. In fact, darkness is used by God a lot. In Genesis 15, God made an unearthly darkness when Abraham was making the covenant with the cloven pieces of the animals. In Exodus 10, it was a darkness that could be felt for 3 days. It was supernatural. It was an eclipse. In Joel 2:10, there's coming a day of darkness. In Nahum, another day of darkness, and that day of darkness arrives during the tribulation, when God makes it a painful darkness. That is a precursor to what we're seeing here. It was divine. And so in Genesis, the first thing that Jesus did as creator was say, "Let there be light." And the work of creation was done in the fullness of light. But from the cross, he reached up and snuffed out the light, because the work of redemption was so horrible and so costly, it could only be done in the dark. God says, "You're not going to watch my son become sin. I'm going to turn the lights out." And God let no one see as he turned his back on his own son. And so as Christ cried, God darkened. And in Matthew 27, verse 46, about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, my God, why have you forsaken me?" What kind of response would God want from such a moment as that? Such a confirmation of Christ's deity. Well, I think that one of the great testimonies is in front of us. In fact, that's why I love the hymn book. In fact, take a moment, grab your little hymn book in front of you and turn to number 188 and look at the third stanza. Because Isaac Watts captures this moment of the supernatural darkness and says in the third stanza of At the Cross, these words, "Well, might the sun in darkness hide and shut her glories in when Christ the mighty maker died for man the creature sins. That's number 188. And then he goes into the refrain, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith. I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At his birth, he put a new star in the sky. At his death, he snuffed out of the sky our brightest star. What a mighty miracle. What a sign to mankind that they were murdering their maker. So he reached up and touched the sun, but now look at verse 51. Remember, Jesus was the new and living way to God. So God the Father says, I have to show you something. And the second of the five miracles. In verse 51, God says, I'm done now. I'm done with that tabernacle and temple, because every part of it was pointing to this moment. Every lamb that was brought, every sacrifice that was made, all the incense, all of those things were pointing at Christ. And so Jesus was the new and living way to God. So God the Father tore the temple curtain open. Now, do you understand what's going on in the temple was that normal people could not approach God? They had to have a priest. A priest would listen to their confession, bear their sacrifice, pour it out before God, and come back and say, you're forgiven. That's what that veil was about. It was a barrier saying, you can't go directly to God. You must go through us. You must have a mediating priest. And so God tore the veil to say, the way is open. You can come right in. It's a new and living way. It's through Christ. Do you know, I mentioned this morning, I think that we don't hear enough what is the disaster of the largest branch of Christendom. The largest branch of Christendom is Roman Catholicism. Do you know what Roman Catholicism is? It's a crude sewing together of the curtain, and that barrier is still there. And you must come to the priest, and the priest goes to God for you, and the priest comes back and dispenses. God says, no. I don't need any more barriers. I don't need, you're all priests, not just the clergy. All of us, we're a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Old Testament worship centered around the tabernacle and then the temple. Divinely designed liturgy was carried on for 1,500 nearly unbroken years, the same way that Moses was told by God to do it on Mount Sinai. By the time of Christ, it just centered on, and this is just one of the many models in Israel, this is actually a scale model with little plastic people in it, showing the immensity, how high the holy place and the Holy of Holies was. And back through that door is a curtain. And that curtain, Josephus said, was as thick as a hand's breadth. It was 6 inches thick of tightly woven rug. And it was massive. And it took scores of men to lift it. It was so heavy and giant. The epicenter of worship was through those doors in the holy place. In the front half of it stood the altar of incense. We saw this morning the golden lampstand that lit it and the table of showbread. The room was divided by a curtain. The curtain was actually a finely woven rug, 4 to 6 inches thick, 60 feet high, 40 feet wide, massive, towering, and it had one message: stay out. That's what that curtain was for. No natural light ever got behind that curtain and penetrated its dark depths. Even the light of the ever-burning lampstand never got in there. It was totally black in there. In better times, the Shekinah glory of the presence of God had made the Holy of Holies behind the veil brighter than the noonday sun, because God, remember, as bright as the sun, glowed over the mercy seat. In all of Israel's history, probably no more than 50 men had ever gone behind that veil. The high priest was high priest for life. And probably no more than 50 generations of priests had gone in there. David never went in. Daniel and Jeremiah never went in. Only the high priest, and only once a year. Inside that room was a box covered with gold. It had the stone tablets of the law, a pot of manna, Aaron's rod that budded. Above the Ark of the Covenant were two golden cherubim with their wings shielding the mercy seat, their faces gazing downward, always focusing on the blood. And when the day came for the high priest to pass behind that veil, he wore bells on the hem of his garment to let the other priests know he was still alive as he went inside. He was garbed carefully in the robes and the priestly garments. There were so many special rules about that. And with trembling hands, he cradled a basin of blood veiled by a cloud of smoke. He had to carry this in one hand, the blood, in the other hand, an incense pot. And it was almost like he only went in there with this cloud around him. And that cloud of smoke kind of was a reminder that he couldn't come alone, and he's carrying the blood, and he came so cautiously. And with trembling hands, holding that basin of blood, veiled by a cloud of smoking incense burning, the high priest entered and sprinkled the blood on the mercy seat on behalf of all the people of God, and then he hastened out. Why? The only purpose of the veil was to keep people out of the holy presence of God. Do you know what God was saying? I'm holy, you're not. Stay out, or you'll get burned up. That was the full meaning of the temple. But on the day that Christ died, can you imagine the scene of those officiating priests? They came in to trim the 12 lampstands. They poured a handful of incense in the fire in front of the altar. They came to change the bread on the table. And then perhaps at the very moment, the veil was touched. And with an unearthly sound, that massive 60-foot-high curtain was violently torn from top to bottom. And aghast, for the first time in nearly 1,500 years, common people looked in at the Holy of Holies, at the mercy seat of God's throne of grace and mercy. And God was saying, anyone that wants to can come in now. Come on in. We're open. And that was the message of the cross. Hebrews 4:16 says, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. What a joyous privilege it is to draw near to Him and come to His presence at any time. We need to think of the offer that Jesus made, that you can come at any time. Come into my presence boldly. Aren't you glad that we live on this side of Calvary instead of the stay out, do not enter, stay away side? Well, God reached up, touched the Son. He reached over, touched the temple. But thirdly, because Jesus was the creator of the universe, God the Father had the rocks cry out. And if you look at verse 51, God the Father had the rocks cry out. Because remember, Jesus said, if you all the people were saying hosannas, and he says, if you don't cry out, the rocks will. No one was crying out. So God made the rocks cry out here in verse 51. It says, behold, the veil of the temple in verse 51 was rent in twain from top to bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent. If you've ever been in an earthquake, there is an unusual sound attached with it. I remember the first time Bonnie and I experienced one in California. She ran and was getting little John, and I ran looking for where we were supposed to go, because they all tell you different things. Go under a doorway, or, you know, there's all these different things you're supposed to do in an earthquake. And I said, I think we should just go outside. And we both ran outside with our precious little newborn. And as we stood there, all of a sudden, it was like you were on a boat in the ocean, and you could see the waves going through the Los Angeles Valley, and you could see the chimneys. First they were high, then they were low as the waves rolled across. But there was that sound that's like not like any other sound. And that sound was localized as the actual rocks that were surrounding the crucifixion of Christ were actually rent and torn asunder by this earthquake that the Lord caused to happen. On Palm Sunday at the triumphal entry, Jesus said to those criticizing him in Luke 19:40, and he answered them and said, I tell you, if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. Here at Calvary, the greatest moment of history, There was no one who would cry out his glory. Only days before, thousands and tens of thousands thronged him, saying, Hosanna, and treated him as king. But now no one raised a voice in protest of the crime of mankind murdering Christ except one, a dying thief. He said, why are you crucifying him? He hasn't done anything wrong. We deserve to be crucified. He was the only one. It makes me ask, where were all of those people? Bartimaeus, you shouted on him on the road to Jericho, where are you now? Why wasn't Bartimaeus saying, don't crucify him? And Lazarus, Jesus just raised him from the dead. Where was Lazarus? And Nicodemus, you came at night. You found eternal life. Why don't you stand up and say something? Matthew, you left your career. Now you're hiding. And Thomas, you bowed his feet and worshiped him in a few days. Where are you now? See, nobody was there. And since no one would speak, God picked a dying thief to seek him as Jesus the Savior and cry, remember me. What a fitting tribute. A pagan Roman governor to put over his head a declaration he was the Messiah, Christ. A callous soldier who stood at the foot of the cross to confess him as Lord and the very Son of God. And he reached down and touched the rocks, and they convulsed, and they cried out to their Maker. Well, now we get to Catherine's question. So here we go. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. So God the Father touched the graves and brought forth from the dead saints who had died in the faith. So the first thing when you have a question is you always have to see what surrounds it. And what surrounds this question is that finally, because Jesus was the one that God had said was the one that those in the graves would hear. Notice what it says in verse 52. The graves were opened, and notice the words God uses, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many. Notice the many emphasis. Many saints dead only hours or buried centuries ago in graves around Israel were touched from the cross by Jesus. After that great earthquake, as people began to go survey the damage, they noticed something strange. All over Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, from north to south, top to bottom, graves had popped open. Perhaps they could just see bones that were turning to dust. But Jesus had touched the graves and they'd popped open. The resurrection of life had spoken. He'd cried out and they popped open. But then on Sunday morning, when Christ stepped from the grave, they stepped from the graves. That's the interesting part. And they, in their new bodies, began to march toward Jerusalem. Can you imagine the uncanny meetings that took place? Out in a field near the cave of Machpelah, a farmer was plowing his field on Sunday morning when he met a man walking across the field. And he said, hello there, what are you doing in my field? And the man says, I am Father Abraham, formerly of Ur, most recently from the happy side of Hades, but I just got popped out and started walking toward Jerusalem. Now, I don't know if God raised Abraham, but just like that, all over Israel, many graves opened, many saints were raised, many saints set their faces, it says, toward Jerusalem. Look what it says. They went into the holy city, and they appeared to many. They all began a beeline walking toward Jerusalem. Can you imagine if someone ran into Elisha or Joseph or Isaac or spoke to Jacob? Can you imagine David coming back, walking around, Samuel? What a commotion it must have been as the first fruits of the resurrection of Christ gathered in the holy city. Why do you think that the whole city turned out to hear Peter? What was going on? What was God doing? It's interesting, and just before we have communion, if you want to look in Acts 26, we have a little clue. When Paul was preaching, by the way, everybody knew about this because it happened to many people, but in Acts 26, near the end of his public ministry while he's on trial, this is what Paul, when he preached to Agrippa, remember the king of the grandson of Herod, the king there, Agrippa, do you remember what Paul said to him? It's amazing when you blend what Paul said to Agrippa with what we just read. and the events of the cross. Acts 26:26. For the king knoweth of these things of whom I speak freely. For I am persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him. For this thing was not done in a corner. Verse 27. King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know that you believe. You see, the resurrection of Christ was not done in a corner. It wasn't done in secret. God reached up, and for 3 hours, the people were scared to death. There was no sun. God reached over, and he split the veil of the temple from top to bottom. What a tear that must have been. Then God reached down and rent the rocks, and they cried out. And then he reached over, and he popped open graves all across the land of Israel. And then the last one, and then we need to have communion. The last one's in verse 54. And because Jesus was the Lamb of God dying for the sin of the world, he reached down and touched the heart of the centurion at the foot of the cross. I think that's one of the most touching, because Matthew 27:54 says, now when the centurion and those that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that were done, they feared greatly and said, truly, this is the Son of God. Why that's significant is a centurion was trained to never fear. That's why Rome always won. As the most trusted soldiers of Caesar's legions, these were the men who looked death in the face and never flinched. They had locked their mighty shields in battle. They would march against countless foes. They never feared. Have you ever paused to think about this scene? Verse 54, what amazing events must have been to make a tough, calloused, hardened centurion fear greatly. Nothing had ever frightened him before. This soldier had been born somewhere in the empire. Perhaps his father was a legionnaire. He listened to the stories. He chose to become one of Caesar's finest. He was a calloused, hard soldier of Rome, and one day on the bulletin board of his barracks, a notice was posted that dispatched him to the most despised corner of the empire, and he went. Not to the lovely coastal port of Caesarea, but of all places on earth, Jerusalem, a city seething with religion, fanaticism, zealots. So on duty one morning, the Roman governor Pilate summoned that centurion and said, take these, crucify them, report back to me when they're dead. A simple assignment. Who were they? He didn't care. 30,000 had already been crucified, just another one for his job. One of them, he thought, was some kind of a king. Well, we'll show him. Well, at 3 p.m., the record was clear. Truly, verse 54, look what he says. This man dying in front of my eyes, truly, this is the Son of God. So God the Father confirmed Christ hung on the cross as he snuffed out the sun, tore the veil, rent the earth, opened the graves, and touched the heart of the centurion. I've often wondered what it was like when that man went home after the tour of duty. People came up to the centurion and said, boy, you're really different. What happened to you on your tour of duty? I can almost hear him say, I met a man at a place called Calvary. He was dying on a cross of wood. That man was God, and that God changed my life. What a Savior. And that's who we've come tonight. To worship the one who died and did all those things from the cross. And let's worship him tonight. As we bow our heads, I invite the elders and deacons to go and prepare to serve us. And as they go, let's just ask the Lord to cleanse us. We're already forgiven, but with heads bowed and eyes closed, we need to ask him to cleanse us, because we don't want to hold the picture of his body and the picture of his blood with hands that are soiled by the sins that so easily beset us. We're already forgiven, but Jesus said we need to ask for him to cleanse us so that with clean hands and pure hearts we can worship him. So here's the question. What happened at the earthquake when the graves were opened in Matthew 27? So, to introduce this, look what Hebrews 2 says, because I want you to think, starting in verse 14,
This is explaining the cross, what Jesus was doing. And then we're going to go in and see the actual event of the earthquake and the graves open. But inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, that's us, he himself, that's Christ, likewise shared in the same, now listen, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. So see, far more was going on at the cross than just a rowdy mob of unbelieving religious Jews and Roman soldiers were crucifying Christ. There is so much more going on. This is one element, that through death, Christ would destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. It's almost like, if you're old enough to remember the 8-track tapes, they were real. They were big and thick, and you had to have this massive player for them. 8 tracks. I mean, that was the hot thing, and you could go between all the different tracks at the same time. It was really neat. Did you know at the crucifixion, there were so many tracks of events going on? There's the whole prophetic track. The most important is the deliverance from the bondage of sin and death that we were under and the universe is under, but also Jesus was destroying him that had the power of death, that is the devil, so that we, verse 15, who through fear of death were all our lifetime subject to bondage, would be released. We are supposed to be able to have this unbelievable joy and freedom from fear and anxiety, knowing that Christ has set an appointment for our death and no one can hasten it and nothing we do can prolong our days, that God has purposes for us in the period of time he's given us here. So let's get into now what happened in Matthew 27. You can be turning there. Basically, what happened is the graves were opened and the saints were raised. But I showed you last time that this is just one of 5 miracles. And the first one was that Jesus put out the light of the sun to show he was the light of the world. See, that's another thing. Jesus not only was you know, redeeming us and destroying the devil, he was also declaring who he was from the cross. I mean, here it looked like he was weak and powerless and held against his will, but he was orchestrating everything that was going on, you know, reaching up and touching the sun to show that he was the light of the world, reaching across from the olive tree he was being crucified onto the temple and splitting the veil to show he was a new and living way. Then in verse 51, he reached down and touched the earth and had the earth, you know, convulse. And I've told you before that I was standing underneath the Temple Mount. There's a tunnel that the Jewish archaeologists have dug. It's actually along the Herodian Wall, along the bedrock, but it's beneath the old city. And I was there with a guide who was the son of a New Jersey circuit court judge who went over there. He was a flower child. He was a rich Jewish kid from New Jersey that went to work on a kibbutz way back in the 70s, right after Haight-Ashbury and that whole thing. And then now he was elderly and he was a guide. And never came to Christ all the time I knew him. But we were walking in that tunnel and he pointed up and he said, look at that. And here was a massive rock beam. It was probably 3 feet thick and about 4 feet high. And I don't know how long, just a massive stone lintel under the Temple Mount that was one of the doorways. And he said, look at that crack. He said, sometime between when that was put up here in 40 BC or whenever it was put up here, he said, and the present, he said, there's been an earthquake that shook this whole ridge. And I said, oh yeah, I know when that was. He said, when? I said, oh, it was about 30, 33 AD. You know, and he didn't like that. But that's what happened. Jesus, the creator of the universe, hit a localized quake right there in the Temple Mount and the rocks rent. And here's what we're looking at tonight, because Jesus is the resurrection and the life. God the Father touched the graves and brought forth from the dead saints who had died in faith. Now, I want to go through that. And then, of course, Jesus, the Lamb of God, reached down and touched. That was the best miracle of all. Putting out the sun, splitting the veil, rending the rocks, opening the graves, all were great. But this is the miracle he's still doing
reaching down and touching the hardened heart of that centurion and bringing him to faith. But point number one, and I'm going to go through each of these tonight. Jesus showed that death was subdued. So look at Matthew 27. If you're not already there, I've got to get there. Matthew 27, and I'm going to read verse 52. And here we go. And it says, "And the tombs were open, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many." This is the miracle we're focusing on tonight. Notice it says tombs were open, and it says many. And it says the bodies of the saints, many, were raised. And then it says that they were resurrected, and showing that as they came out of the tombs, after his resurrection, they entered the city. What's fascinating is that God was saying, I want you to look at what was going on this cross, and he did that at every channel possible. For those that were really into the sun, and remember, a lot of the ancients worshiped the sun, he put it out. For those that were really into religion, he tore the veil. For those that were really into, you know, terra firma, he shook. For those that were into, you know, death being the end of all, he raised people to life. He touched everything. So that was the pointing out that death was subdued. It couldn't even fall before him. But this is what's interesting. Jesus is giving a foretaste of the final resurrection. Now, why I'm saying that is that, you know, there was this general belief in a final resurrection. Remember at the raising of Lazarus in chapter 11 of John, Mary says, "Well, I know he'll rise again." Jesus said, "No, I'm going to raise him right now." She said, "I know he'll rise again at the final resurrection." Jesus said, "No, I'm the resurrection and the life." And so that people did not really understand that Jesus had that power of resurrection, of not only granting life, but giving someone back their life. And so this was a foretaste. We don't understand certain aspects of these miracles. The torn veil is the easiest to decipher because that's what talks about in Hebrews, that there's a new and living way. But why the darkness? God just liked that. He used it with Moses. He's going to use it in the tribulation. But what's interesting is we don't know much about what specifically happened. Now, I'm just going to talk about what we do know. What we don't know is this. We don't know whether these saints had died long ago or only recently. We don't know. It doesn't say whether this was a permanent resurrection. Now, when Elijah raised people from the dead, they had to die again. When Jesus raised from the dead the widow of Nain's, you know, son and Lazarus, they had to die again. It doesn't say whether these had to die again. I'll tell you my opinion. What we do know is that the report was historic. Why? Because Matthew wrote it down while people were living that were there. And so there was no contest to this report. There were enough witnesses that when they saw what Matthew recorded, they went, yeah, we remember that. See, the early church concurred that this was a historic event. So we know that from the testimony of those around. But what we can suppose is that this was a foretaste of the final resurrection, that God is going to reach down and touch the graves. Now, what we also know is this, and I like this. Come on. You're not cooperating tonight. Foretaste of the resurrection. I'm going to have to walk over here every time. These saints raised were also a fulfillment, remember, of all these prophecies through the Levitical system. And turn with me for just a moment to Leviticus chapter 23. You were there this morning. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, third book of the Bible. And remember, I told you that Leviticus, almost the entire book is dictated. I mean, if you could make a color, if red is Christ's words in the Gospels, if you could make green God's words in Leviticus, almost the whole book would be green because it's all just, and the Lord said, and the Lord said. But look what he says in Leviticus 23, verses 10 through 14. And this is fascinating. This is one of the feasts of the Lord, and it's actually the Feast of First Fruits. And verse 9, "And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying," so it's God is dictating this, saying, "Write this down. Speak to the children," chapter 23:10, "of Israel, and say to them, when you come into the land and which I give you and reap its harvest, you shall bring a sheaf of the first fruits of your harvest to the priest. and he will wave the sheaf before the Lord to be accepted on your behalf. On the day after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. What's the day after Sabbath? It's on Sunday. So the first fruits was a waving of a sheaf on Sunday. And you shall offer it on that day when you wave the sheaf, a male lamb of the first year without blemish, burnt offering. Its grain offering shall be 2/10 of an ephah, and on. I mean, you can read. It's just fascinating, the detail. Now, think about this. John Walford, former president of Dallas, when I went there in the old days where I got my degree from Dallas, this is what he wrote. This was a fulfillment, the people coming out of the graves he's talking about, of the feast of first fruits of harvest mentioned in Leviticus 23. On that occasion, as a token of the coming harvest, the people would bring a handful of grain to the priest. The resurrection of these saints occurring after Jesus himself was raised was a token of the coming harvest of saints. Now it's got a mind of its own. Look at that. It moved. Right there, the saints raised were like a handful of grain. The first fruits was saying, the harvest is coming. Phil, are you doing that in the back? It's just to keep everybody awake. Did you know if there's enough movement, that's what they've learned with advertising. If you make them quick enough, people pay attention the whole time, they don't want to miss anything. But the saints raised were kind of a fulfillment of Leviticus 23. There's just a handful of the harvest. Now, number four. Jesus is the judge. And I want you to turn to John 5, because there's another thing I think was going on here. John chapter 5. Jesus had, previous to the cross, said something. And it's amazing. You can say anything, but you don't know if it's true. You know, I could claim anything, and it would take a long time to verify it. Jesus claimed something in chapter 5. And that is this. In chapter 5, verse 22, Jesus said, I'm the judge with the final verdict for everyone. And he said, I'm the only one. Listen. He said, look at me and listen. I'm the only one who, when I talk, people in the grave can hear my voice. That's why Jesus in chapter 11 said, Lazarus, come forth. If he'd have just said, come forth, it would have been a general resurrection. People would have just stepped out of the dust all around. I mean, have you ever thought about all the billions of people that have lived? There are 7 billion alive right now. Depending on who's calculating, even the United Nations says there is an immense number of billions of humans that have lived on this planet. All of them, the dust of their bodies is around us. In fact, you heard about the little boy that came home from Sunday school and he was kneeling by his bed praying, and his mother heard him gasp, and she said, what's wrong, honey? And he said, well, in Sunday school, the teacher says that God made man from the dust of the earth, and he looked under his bed. He said, someone's either coming or going under here. You know, that's true. The dust of the earth is filled with a lot of people that are around us. And if Jesus would have said, come forth, all around Palestine, Israel, and the Middle East, people would have started rising out of the ground. But look what it says in chapter 5, verse 22. For the Father judges no one. Wow. But has committed all judgment to the Son, that all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Wow. Now look at verse 24. Most assuredly, he said, I can't say this more firmly. I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life. There's the essence of salvation. Hearing and responding to the word of God. Not hearing and responding to an emotional, moving message. Remember, I was a youth pastor for many years. I was a youth evangelist. I traveled. I used to fly across the country and do youth rallies all over the place. And they trained us for those invitations. And usually I would get at least 1/2 to 3/4 of everybody that was there to come forward for something. And I'm not saying that's bad. It was an event. But I was trained in how to get their attention, hold their attention, and to say things that stunned them, and they would respond to it. Jesus said, no, this is salvation, not being emotionally moved. He who hears my word, that's why when you preach, make sure the Bible is in there.
When you share the gospel, don't just tell stories, share scripture. It's alive and powerful and sharper than any scalpel, and it can cut through. So share the word. But everyone who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has, at that moment, everlasting life. Someone this morning in the visitor line somewhere said to me, oh, I'm struggling. My Roman Catholic family is enamored with the last 6 days of the Pope here. I said, no, just ask them, do they know at this instant they have everlasting life? Do they know at this instant that all their sins are forgiven? That's what we do, and they don't know. They hope, they wish. They're asking their relatives to burn candles for them and to do masses, but they don't know that every sin, past, present, and future, is paid for, and they don't know that they have eternal life. Jesus said, if you hear my word and believe on him who sent me, you have everlasting life, and you will not come into judgment. He says, I know that because I'm the judge. But you have passed from death into life. Verse 25, most assuredly, he says it again, I say to you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has given life in himself, he has granted to the Son to have life in himself, and has given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Do not marvel at this, verse 28, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. Jesus is the judge. And he said, people in the graves can hear my voice. And so from the cross, as he hung there, at that earthquake, God says, I'm going to demonstrate that Jesus holds the verdict, the final verdict for everyone, and he's going to call forth these that I believe were the first fruits. Well, now turn from John to Acts, because there's another thing that the bodies out of the grave show us. Acts 17, and starting in verse 31, because he has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness, and it's given us to assurance by all this, by raising him from the dead. This is Paul talking to pagans and saying, I want you to know something. He starts in verse 24. He says, the creator, there is a creator. By the way, the Greeks were evolutionary in their thought. They were materialistic. They wanted everything to come from something other than, you know, one unique divine being, and they were materialists. And he says, no, there's a creator, and he made, and you can read it, and he is the Savior, verse 27. You can seek and grope after him. So the Creator is knowable. He's not far from each of us, verse 27 says. That means he's within an arm's length. But look, verse 31, he has appointed a day which he will judge the world. The Creator, who is a Redeemer, is also the judge. Kind of reminds me of the old Lucy show. Do you remember where they pulled into town and they wanted to stay at the, and the guy takes the hat off and he becomes the bell captain, and then they need something else and he puts a different hat on, and then he becomes the mayor, and then he's the sheriff. Well, that's funny, but Jesus is the creator, and that's true. He's the redeemer, and he's the judge. So on every level, you can't escape him. He originates all things. He is the one who offers to pay for all sin. All sins are forgivable. And he's the judge. And on the judgment day, he'll tell each one all the times they refused to respond to him. He has the final verdict. Next, number five, Paul explains the stages. Now, this is where it gets interesting, and this is what I believe happened. So turn to 1 Corinthians 15. I want to show you this. Because Paul explains three stages of the resurrection in 1 Corinthians 15, 20 to 23. And let me get there with you. 1 Corinthians 15, 20 to 23. And you notice it's fascinating if you pull apart what Paul says. 15, 20. It says, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. And that's where I really believe that Matthew 27 is an explanation of verse 20 to 23. For since man came by death, as man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all shall die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Each one in his own order. Now look at the orders. Christ, here's the first one. Secondly, in verse 23, the first fruits. And then, look at this. Verse 23 continues, and afterward, those who are Christ's at his coming. So, what we could say is, number three group, Christ at his coming, is the rapture, which even that has two parts, the dead and the living. And so there's actually two separate types of resurrection. There's a resurrection of dead bodies, and then there's a transformation of living bodies into celestial bodies. There's Christ, but this, if you divide this, if you don't say Christ the first fruits, because Christ the first fruits, Christ could be the first fruit, but Christ the first fruits, the first handful. Christ was raised as a fulfillment of the first fruits, but the people coming out of the grave, I believe, in Matthew 27, were the first fruits, the handful that promises all the rest are going to come. So I personally believe that Paul is explaining three stages. Christ, the first fruits, those that came out of the grave, and then those that are Christ that is coming. So personally, to answer the question, I believe that these people actually got their go-to-heaven bodies. They stepped out of the grave, and they did not have mortal bodies that had to die again. I believe that the Lord just raised them up. And so, let me take you to this one, because otherwise, there we go. There are other stages of the resurrection. You notice that there are a whole bunch of levels of people being raised through the Bible. Don't think this is unique. There's Enoch. Enoch was translated. It says, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, because God took him. For before this, he had this testimony that he pleased God. So Enoch went from being a normal, the seventh from Adam guy. Enoch's walking along one day. By the way, he didn't start walking with the Lord at the first. It says that Enoch was 65 years old, and he began to walk with the Lord, and he walked with the Lord for all of those till he was 365 days old or years old, and then he was taken, and the Lord took him. And so there's a resurrection. Elijah was resurrected. A chariot of fire came down, and he stepped into it, and he swooped off. And that, again, was a transformation, kind of like a rapture, both of these. Enoch was taken out just before the flood. So he was before the flood, which is kind of like the church. And Noah was preserved through the flood, through it, and that's kind of like Israel. And then the world perished, and that's kind of like everybody that's during the tribulation. They perished. So Enoch portrays a little bit of this pulled out before, like we believe the church will be. Elijah, another resurrection. Christ, he's the first fruits. Then I believe these that were raised through that earthquake. Then 1 Corinthians 15:23 goes on to say, those who belong to Christ. And that's what I believe is this group. For the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then, here's the sixth group of, and there are, by the way, 10 different groups of people that are going to be resurrected. The living saints at the rapture. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him. We. Paul was so aware of any moment Christ coming, he included himself in the group. He said, then we. That's his first epistle. Paul, from the beginning, was expectant and lived every day like Christ may come. And what a fascinating thing to think that those who belong to him, those who are the dead in Christ, those who are sleeping in Jesus, Paul said, don't sorrow as those who have no hope. So that means sorrow, but sorrow hopefully. Because they are sleeping, their bodies are, but they are in Christ's presence, no soul sleep. Consciousness in Christ's presence, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says that. But they're going to get their resurrection body, and then we, who are alive and remain at the rapture, caught up, we get ours. Here's another resurrection, the two witnesses. Who are they? The Bible doesn't say. Who might they be? They sound a lot like Moses and Elijah. By their miracles, they do. Some have said Elijah and Enoch, because those two had never died, and they need their, you know, shot at death, and so the beast kills them. But they are resurrected and ascend directly to heaven. So they get given life, and they get bodies that are celestial that can go to heaven. Then some more, the martyrs. I mean, look at Revelation 20 and verse 4. This is another resurrection. Revelation 20 and verse 4. It says, "And I saw thrones, and they that sat on them, and the judgment was committed to them. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness of Jesus, for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast, nor had the mark on their foreheads. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. So these who were martyred during the tribulation are resurrected to reign with Christ. Now, we know that the disciples were promised to sit on thrones then too, and so there seems to be both those that are already glorified as well as these who are coming out of the tribulation. Now, this is interesting. Now, this is dispensationalism, point nine. I mean, in all charts that you read, they say, well, the saints who die during the millennium. Now, that's only logic. Where does it say anybody dies in the millennium? It does say, who dies? Only those who are rebels die during the millennium. It says in Isaiah that a person will thought to be a mere child if they die at 100 years. So what it appears is, during the millennium, that it is a rolling back of the curse and a rolling back of the elements that cause us to live shorter lives. Do you remember right after the flood, Methuselah lived, you know, 969 years or however long he lived, you know, and all those patriarchs lived. Adam lived 950 years and Noah lived 900 and something years. Those are real figures. Those people lived almost 1,000 years and they were sinners. So it's very possible that no one dies during the millennium except for rebels. God quashes rebellion. And if anybody is a rebel, zoop, 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 he's quashing it until the end, and then he lets them all rebel. And you can read that in chapter 20. So classic dispensationalism, it's nothing wrong with saying it. This is logical. Everyone dies. Uh-huh. Everyone will die, but it appears God prolongs life. That's why there are more people living during the millennium than have ever lived. Ever. Because for 1,000 years, there are no poisonous spiders, there are no poisonous snakes, there are no carnivores, there are no sharks biting people and eating people. By the way, if you listen to the news, more people died of taking selfies this year than were eaten by sharks. So don't take selfies, you know, because you'll fall off. That poor lady that was standing by, you know, the cliff and fell right over. Boy, what a selfie that was. I hope she was saved, you know, as she went over that clip. Number 10, this is going to be another resurrection, transformation kind, because the living saints at the end of the millennium, they are still humans in normal human bodies. The people that are the descendants, you know, the children of the children of the children that are living this whole 1,000 years, they have to be changed too. And you can just read it. It's very short what it says in Revelation 20. Verse 7, when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan is released from his prison. He's in the pit down there with all those horrible demons and everybody, all the lost. And he goes out to deceive the nation, verse 8, which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, and he gathers them together to battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. And they go up in the breadth of the earth and surround the camp of the saints and the beloved city. In other words, they go to the millennial temple in Jerusalem and surround the camp of the saints and the beloved city. And God says, enough is enough, and fire comes down and devours them. And the devil, who can't be devoured by fire, who deceived them, is cast into the lake of fire, where the beast and the false prophet are. How'd they get there? They're put in chapter 19. That means there's no annihilationism. That means people don't, it's not a bug zapper, you know, gone. That's what, you know, some accommodating theologians say, that God is too loving to forever punish anyone. If he says, I have loved you with an everlasting love, if he says that there's no tongue or voice where my tongue or language where my voice is not heard, if he is the one who lights everyone that comes into the world, if he said, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, come to me, look unto me, all the ends of the earth, and be saved. If God made such an offer and we refuse it, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? So they are going to be consumed. The false prophet and the beast are already thrown in. The devil is thrown in with them into the lake of fire and brimstone, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. And that's going to be at that point somewhere in there, the living saints who are in the camp of God after he incinerates all the rebels, those will have to be transformed. And that's another stage of resurrection. Those are the 10 stages the Bible talks about. Okay, that was the sixth point. Point seven, now it gets interesting. Look with me in Ephesians, because Ephesians 4:9, what is going on with this crew? Well, Jesus did something. It says in Ephesians 4:9, now this, he ascended, what does it mean but that he first descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things, and he gave some to be apostles and all that. What is that? Well, Jesus' ascension from earth to heaven in Acts 1:9 through 11 was preceded by he first descended. And this refers to Christ, not only his incarnation, but the lower parts of the earth are, the phrase here is speaking of Christ's descent between his crucifixion and resurrection beyond the earth, the grave, and death to the very pit of demons. That's very interesting. People that try and, you know, they like to make the Bible has as few amazing things in it as possible. They go, oh, it couldn't mean that. But it appears that Jesus visited the grave. And that he went down there. Well, it doesn't just appear. Here's another point. Look at Colossians 2:15. Jesus does something spectacular. So the next book. And Paul, interestingly enough, preaches on this. It's astounding. Colossians 2. He's talking about everything that Christ did on the cross. It starts way back up in verse 11. You were circumcised and buried, verse 12. And you were made alive in verse 13. In verse 14, he wiped out the handwriting requirements. This is everything that Christ did, having nailed it to the cross. But look what else he did, verse 15. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. What is that? Well, that's using the language that everybody in Colossae would have understood, and everybody in the Roman Empire would have understood, because every time the Romans won a war, the general was led in a triumph. It was the ultimate honor of life that this conquering general would have the triumphal entry into Rome. And the historians, you can read about it. It was a spectacle beyond all spectacles. But part of it was showing those that were captives that were liberated and showing the victors. And basically what Colossians 2:15 says is, having disarmed is a work of the cross, that the ultimate doom, that's Satan defeated. That's what we read about in Hebrews 2. Destroyed him that had the power of death, that is the devil. So part of this is that Jesus disarmed the one who had the power of death. He took the fangs out of Satan's mouth. But this principalities and powers, look what it says. He disarmed principalities and powers. Jesus went to the abode of the demons and announced that he had won. I remember the old Steve Green song that he sang about how the devil couldn't believe that Jesus came forth out of the grave. What he was referencing 20 years ago in that song was this verse, that Jesus went down and declared his victory over Satan. I mean, do you think Satan knew that he was accomplishing God's plan? No, he doesn't understand the Bible. He thought he ruined it all by crucifying, having Christ crucified. And so Jesus hung on the cross, died, put into the grave. His body stayed there. He went down and he proclaimed. He made a public spectacle, triumphing over them. This is the picture of the Roman general. This is the parade that the Roman general that was in their mind. Only Jesus was the conqueror, and he comes down in triumph to tell all of the hosts of Satan that God had won, and they were defeated. Now, where this is talked about, keep going to the right to 1 Peter 3. I mean, this is fascinating. Peter really liked this, and he talks about it more than anybody else. So go Colossians, 1st, 2nd Thessalonians, 1st, 2nd Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, James, 1 Peter, there we go. And look at 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 19, because this is amazing. Jesus proclaimed his triumph in the abyss. Now, just to get the setting, Ezekiel, don't turn there, but Ezekiel 32 calls this place the pit. And the pit is the place where everyone that has ever lived in history is there right now, except for the redeemed. They're not there. They were previously on the happy side of Hades, the grave, the pit, with Abraham, called Abraham's bosom. But now they were led in triumph by Christ. But look at what happens in 1 Peter 3:19. Between Christ's death on the cross and his resurrection, declaring his triumph publicly and showing the tomb empty, he was still alive, and he went down and proclaimed something to a specific group of demons. Demons are fallen angels, and these demons are chained. Now look what it says. Verse 18, 1 Peter 3, "For Christ also suffered once for sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. By whom," that means by the Spirit, "he also went," that's Christ, "went and preached to the spirits in prison." That's curious. Spirits in prison. Wow. "Who formerly," do you remember the demons when Jesus would cast a demon out? They go, "Oh, don't make us go to the pit." And Jesus said, "You can go." He didn't make, see, they know about this prison house. They know about this abyss lockup, the ultimate penitentiary. "Whom also he went and preached the spirits in prison." Verse 20, "Who's in prison? Who formerly were disobedient when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah." Do you remember the days of Noah? Genesis 6:5. It was the worst time in the history of the world. Every imagination was only evil continually of every human. It was a humanity absolutely corrupt to the core. Never has there been a time like that. Even today, it's not as bad. Until the tribulation, it's going to be the same then. While God is manifesting himself in blinding sun scorchings and 60-pound hailstones crushing people, and all the waters being poisoned, and demon hordes allowed out of the pit, that pit, there are other divisions. There are some demons that are so dangerous, God holds them in there, he's going to let them out. One of them, the destroyer, Abaddon, is so bad that he would kill everybody. He's that horribly, viciously powerful. But these, specifically, during the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight souls were saved, these, you can read about them in Jude, and I won't take you there, but these are the ones that were causing so much damage and defilement that God says, I'm not letting you out. You're going down into this pit. And so to those who tried to, by the way, what were they doing? God promised Eve that her seed would crush Satan's head. That was the proto-evangelium. the first proto, protos, the first declaration of evangelium, the gospel. So in Genesis 3:15, it says that the serpent would bruise Christ's heel, but Christ would crush the serpent's head. The seed of the woman. By the way, women don't have seed, men do. So this was even speaking of a divine prophecy of the virgin birth of Christ, that a child not born in the natural way would crush Satan. Well, trying to destroy that, the demons come and they defile and destroy the bloodline, and only one line was left for Christ to come through, and it's through Noah and through his son, Shem, the Semitic people. And so that whole process was closing in, and there were only 8 genetically pure, ready to be the heir through which Christ would come, and those demons were doing everything they could to squelch the last line. And so God says, oh, and he puts them in jail. They're still there. And what does Jesus do? He went, in verse 19, and preached. Now, there's interesting. There's two words for preaching. There is keruso and euangelizomai. My. Keruso means you stand and declare on a street corner like a herald. You know, a herald would stand on the street corner, pull out the scroll and say, the emperor says. And all he did is deliver a message. That's a herald. This one is preach the gospel and offer to people salvation. Jesus did not preach and offer salvation to the spirits in prison. There's no second chance for anyone, demons or humans. Jesus declared as a herald that God won. You know, the pastor from Grand Rapids, whatever his name was, the guy that defected from the faith, wrote Love Wins, or whatever he called it. Actually, God wins, and he is loving. But he so loved the world, he gave his son. Anybody that rejects it will pay for it forever. And he declared that he made it to those spirits in prison, and he went and preached to the spirits in prison that were there. So that's fascinating. That's another event that's going on. But the final point is this, and I will now answer this question. If you go back to Acts 17, I believe that Jesus demonstrated from the cross, starting in verse 24, that he was the one that made the world and everything in it. He is Lord of heaven and earth. He doesn't dwell in temples. He has made from one blood, verse 26, every nation of the earth. So there on the cross, Jesus is declaring he's creator. He has control over the sun. He has control over the earth. He also, in verse 27, said, I'm the one that you can grope after. And one person did at the cross, the thief. And he said, remember me. He said, remember me. He's reaching out to Christ by faith. And Jesus said, today, you'll be with me in paradise. That means he got to go to heaven with Christ. He got to go to paradise, which is in Christ's presence. And Jesus said, today you're going to be with me there. And so what did Jesus do? When he died and when the thief was killed, he went down and their bodies stayed there, but Jesus went down to the grave where that thief went, to the happy side, because he was a believer. Where Abraham was, where Isaac and where Jacob and where, you know, Job and Daniel and all of them were down there. And Jesus took them and took them as his triumphal group. And he takes them from the grave, because it says in Hebrews 11 that they without us should not be perfected. On the other side of the cross, they have the benefits of not being down there in that pit anymore, but being in the presence of God where we're going. But Jesus also resurrected from that cross people all over. That's him saying that I am the one through him. I'm not far from you. In him you live and move, verse 28 says. And we are commanded to repent, verse 30. He's the Savior. And so he took those with him as the first fruits, the handful of grain. And I mean, half the commentators believe that they were given resurrection bodies, and the other half believe they had to die again. I don't think that the scriptures infer they had to die again. I believe that they're more like Enoch and more like Elijah, and that they were taken up with Christ in his triumphal procession to heaven. So that's what he was doing, but it's all part of him declaring, I'm the Creator, I'm the Savior, and then warning in verse 31, because he has appointed a day, Acts 17:31, in which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man he has ordained and has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. You know what we should do? We should be like Paul. We're living in a pagan, post-Christian world where the murder of babies is fine and the murder of old people is going to soon be fine, and where we all have our own sexual identity. That's the new government term. And because we have our sexual identity, we have sexual rights. So that means that we can do anything we want to do with this body, and we can just be our own moral agent and live like we want. And so what we have to do is proclaim Jesus as the Creator, and every human down deep has somewhere buried and out of sight the image of God, the reflection of God, and the conscience that God put in, and tell them that, and as we have each heard, that there is a Redeemer who is the Creator, and that we're all sinners, and that he is the judge. And Jesus affirmed all that from the cross when he reached down. And to finally answer the question, I believe he raised from the dead a select group, not all, just a handful of grain, like Leviticus 23 said, a wave offering, a little sheaf, a handful, many. He has big hands. And he raised them, and they walked into the city, and when Jesus ascended, he took them with him. And they are like Moses, I mean, they're like Elijah and Enoch. They're with him in heaven. And I believe that that was for us to be able to affirm that Jesus is the Creator, the Savior, and the Judge. And it's 7:05. So either we can haul out the microphones and sit here for 9 more minutes, or you can go home early and say that church got out early. So why don't we stand and we'll set a record. That means this is for all the times I've been late, that we get out 9 minutes early. And next week we'll have the microphones in the aisle, and I already had one of our teenagers say, when can I ask my question? I said, next week, because I need to pile up another 6 or 7 of them. But let's bow before the Lord. Thank you, Father in heaven, that all who are in the dust, in the grave, can hear the voice of Jesus. Those that have done good to the resurrection of life, those that have done evil to the doom of paying forever for the sin that they never allowed you to pay for. I pray that we would be ambassadors of your reconciliation, that you would change how we look at life, that we would start looking at people around us as every one of them being a candidate for heaven. We don't know if they'll respond. Only you know if they will respond. All we're supposed to do is point the gospel toward them and share it verbally after we live it and after we get some way of communicating to them, and just share the gospel. And if we see the door open of their heart, we know you opened it. But Father, we're not the heart openers. We're just the ambassadors declaring the gospel. And I pray that we would tell people that we know our Creator, that he has become our Savior, because there's a day he's going to judge the world. And we want to share the good news before it's too late for them. Help us to live redemptively. Help us to live confidently, because we've heard your voice and we know we have endless life. I pray that you'd use us this week until you come for us or call us home. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you as you go.